have a brief story. I'll keep this brief. I talked about my kids last year, and I thought I'd bring them up again this year. So it's about using technology in ways not intended. So my son, he's 16. He got 2 years ago, saved all of his birthday money, all of his Christmas money, and got an Oculus headset. So that's a virtual reality headset. I see some nodding heads. Other people have. How many of you guys have used a virtual reality headset at some point? That's a lot of people. That's most of the room. So very cool. I tried it out. There's a couple of really cool games. I thought this is great. He loves it. And then came COVID. This is kind of during COVID, and I was in a big push to get my kids outside and get some exercise. Go do some. I don't care what it is. Just go outside and do something. And he said, "Dad, I already exercised." I'm like, "What do you? You didn't exercise. You've been sitting downstairs in the basement all day." And he said, "Well, yeah, but I was on VR." And I said, "Sitting on VR like this is not exercise." And he said, "Well, no, I was playing a boxing game." I said, "Sitting on VR playing a boxing game is not exercise." And he challenged me. So I went downstairs. He put on his boxing game for me. And three rounds later, it took about 10 minutes for me to get knocked out, dripping sweat. I can't emphasize enough how sweaty I was. And threw a shirt, and I said, "Okay, fine. We'll let that count as exercise." So virtual reality in my house became exercise. Our next speaker is going to talk about the way it's being used in healthcare, which I think, again, not maybe how virtual reality was intended to be used, but it's a really cool use where we can take it into a clinical setting and have some really cool outcomes. So next up, we're going to have Nikki Caputo from UCHealth, and she's going to talk about virtual reality in healthcare.
Hey, everybody. Hold on. How many have used? I'm just kidding. He stole my question, so we'll just go forward. I think what's really important about any technology is that it inspires us and it creates human connection. So if there's one thing you remember today, the entire day after I'm done talking, whatever it is, don't just insert technology for the sake of doing something cool. Always make sure that it enhances human connection in any way. And there's not one technology out there, and I will argue this point all the time, that doesn't enhance human connection if done properly. So remember that. Everything else is fair game.
Packed my bags last night, pre-flight. 0 hour, 9 a.m. And I'm gonna be high as a kite by then. It's lonely out.
That is my favorite commercial of all time. That is from 2018, so it's 2023. It's a perfect indication of how long UCHealth has been looking at VR. We actually started This pilot that I'm going to talk about here in a second was in 2018. The technology was a little different then. You saw that incredible commercial was all about using your Samsung phone in a piece of plastic. It has changed quite a bit. You can now get a great workout while doing boxing. The resolution is a lot better. And just like any technology, every month it gets better and better and better. And the hardware kind of becomes less relevant and the content actually becomes more relevant, which is what's important in healthcare and what's important to us. So back in 2018, we, you know, heard about this technology. It had actually been around for over a decade in healthcare. The first kind of VR experience was a snowball fight type experience in a burn center to help mentally kind of decompress, remove you from that pain when you're doing wound dressings. And so it's been a couple decades in total. In some form of virtual reality or not. So we wanted to figure out, well, how are we gonna do it? We need to talk to patients, we need to talk to staff. And what we really found out, and this is not new, this is not rocket science, every patient's in a different point of where they're at in their journey. And our pilot actually focused on patients receiving chemotherapy in our infusion centers. We went across the Front Range, Fort Collins, Denver, and Colorado Springs, all different regions, patients at varying levels, different types of facilities, to really try to understand. And I don't really need to read these quotes for you guys to kind of get a sense of, you know, where they're at, especially when they're sitting in a chair receiving a treatment. So it really kind of set the stage of where we wanted to go and how we wanted to use the technology. And in that pilot, we basically were told by both patients, caregivers, that we should probably do this. We've done a lot of studies over the years and looked at different technologies and different types of experiences. Never once did we get this type of result. In fact, if you look at the patient use, percent of patients who would use VR again, one of those patients was like, absolutely not. And I went and I talked to her. She's like, I would never use this again because this is my last cancer treatment and I don't ever expect to be here again. Probably the best answer I've ever heard. And I was totally fine with her never using VR again. And so from this information, you know, we really tried to look at, all right, let's figure out how we roll this out, how we expand it across our system. But we needed to understand more about why we'd use it. So it's one thing to give someone a headset during a long treatment and distract them from their current environment, take them to the Grand Canyon, take them mountain biking up in Steamboat. We really need to understand what is it actually doing? What is the actual intervention? We found six different themes. The first one is that it gave patients something to look forward to. So those are long treatments. And if you know that it's there for you when you're coming in, it's kind of something that's fun. Whether it is a boxing game, whether it is some kind of game that distracts you or you are taken away, it's something you know that's there and you can get excited about. The concept of time disappears. So a lot of patients talked about the fact that time kind of just sped up because they were completely taken away and distracted by this content, something new. And so they really didn't, a four-hour treatment kind of was compressed a little more. We got a lot of people talking about how there's distraction and then there's an actual escape, right? So what's really important with content is that it is unique to everybody. So you may not like whitewater rafting. That's probably not the best content for you if you truly want real distraction and real escape. And so what's really important, what we learned from this one, is that that content has to matter. I have to identify with it. I have to like it, understand it, be excited by it. And when that happens, you actually feel like you've escaped away from where you currently are. One step further, we had a lot of patients talk about how they just kind of, even for a brief second, while they're rafting down that river in the Grand Canyon, escape from their illness altogether. and just were mentally taken to another place where they didn't have to think about it. That's a pretty powerful thing if you think about it. These are 2-minute, sometimes 5-minute pieces of content that just let you think about something completely different and take you away. There's one story I have from this pilot specifically. I think it was in Colorado Springs, and she was very, very reluctant to do VR, which it's not for everybody. Technology is not for everybody. It's completely based on, you know, giving it a try and then seeing if it's for you. And so we just walked away. But then her sister came over to us and said, you know, she's like this in her chair. She was just diagnosed with breast cancer. She was her first time in the infusion center and really nervous, really scared. And her sister came up and was like, please just ask again. I talked her into it, and I was kind of like, you know, I'll go ask her again, but it's totally up to her, you know. So we walked over there, and you know how sisters can be. I have two of them. Talked her into it. We put the headset on her, and she loved art. So we had her walk through a Monet painting. So put the headset on, and you're actually in Starry Night, or it's Van Gogh. I'm obviously don't love art as much as she does. And it was incredible. Put the headset on her, and her shoulders went from this to completely relaxed. She almost slumped in her chair a little bit. Her arms fell off the armrests, and she just escaped into that painting. And like everything before in those bullet points, escaped from where she was. And I actually saw the anxiety kind of lift and the fear kind of lift out of her body as she had that headset on. And it, I mean, when you witness it, it's one thing to talk about it and me standing up here telling you, but when you actually see it, you know that it's something that can make a difference. And I think what's, you know, really important to us at UCHealth is that it's a type of technology that can provide experiences that let people live their best life and really try something different and take them away and take them into, whether it's creating a connection, which I'll talk here in a minute, or, you know, taking you to something you love. I think that is a pretty powerful approach to care and a supplement to care for a variety of different use cases. And these quotes aren't coming in like they should. Can anyone read that? So we're gonna just skip through. Gotta love PowerPoint and the differences and how things happen. All right, so what have we done since that pilot? We've expanded pretty much across the entire system, although right now we're kind of in a relaunch, and I'll talk about that in a second. But since 2018, we've delivered over 15,000 different experiences across the system to patients. This quote down here in the bottom is actually from a patient who was outpatient wound care at PVH, and it was during COVID. And she had a kind of a painful dressing that she had to get changed every once in a while. So she'd come in and was always kind of just afraid, a little anxious about it. And these guys had a VR headset and talked about how she'd always wanted to go on had her balloon ride. She actually had one scheduled, but it was canceled during COVID, and she has a chronic condition that kind of kept her from it. We were actually able to put her in a hot air balloon with the headset while she was getting that dressing changed. And again, it's one of those things that you have to be there to see it, to really be moved by it. But she's brought to tears and kind of thinking like, wow, I wasn't able to do this. I'm at a place I really don't want to be because it's not awesome to have this wound dressing changed. But we were able to give her an experience that she's been waiting to do for a long time while having a dressing change that she wasn't really looking forward to. And so it's things like these. I think we've gone beyond just outpatient infusion and wound care. And I'll talk a minute about a needle aversion example, but we've now expanded into our labs, into dialysis, basically oncology across the system, really looking at pre-procedure. We know that for the right people, it really can kind of reduce that anxiety and just make you feel a little more at ease. So can we use it there? So there's been a bunch of different pilots that we've been running across the system. And why we took it offline was because we are now focused on really just making it universally available. We now have what we call PTTs across the system that really help with technology. Because one of the hardest parts about implementing any technology anywhere is actually operationalizing it. We've got nurses and clinicians working at the top of their scope, and the last thing they need to do is worry about a headset and if it's working or not, if it's connected to Wi-Fi. And so within the last year, all the pieces have been, kind of been falling together on how do we actually operationalize this and try to offer it to patients who fit these use cases, but make it easy on our staff, because it can't be just another thing. It will not get used. It'll just sit in a corner. And so that's one of our biggest challenges, and that's what we're working on right now to make sure that it's available across our system. All right, so I'm going to walk through a few collaborations that we've used to VR. So the first one, this is my favorite story. I was actually just talking to someone about this. This was during COVID. And she had been an infusion patient at Harmony in Fort Collins for years, for a long time. And she loved VR. She loved classical music. But if you're a patient that's there all the time, you know, you've probably gone through all the content. And so we'd constantly be looking for new classical music for her, new music for her, anything. And we learned that Colorado Symphony was actually doing a special concert at Red Rocks for like 175 people, all spaced out. And so we just called them up and said, hey, can we put our camera right in the center of the stage and film it in 360 and offer it to our patients? I mean, they said yes immediately. it was not a hard sell. It was pretty incredible. And we put that patient and any other patient that wanted to watch it center stage at Red Rocks for a Vivaldi concert with the Colorado Symphony. And this little screen grab from the experience does not do it justice. But it started out, the sun was up, and by the time the concert was over, the sun had gone down. And if you've ever seen kind of a sunset at Red Rocks, it's a pretty special thing. So the music plus that, plus being taken away to that experience was pretty incredible. This is another one. This is where I talked about needle aversion. A lot of people don't like getting shots. They don't like needles. They don't like getting their blood drawn. We learned that through a few special patients, but we're able to get a lot of people over their fear. Especially, this is specific to the COVID vaccine, but you know, we've kind of been doing it since in different labs across the system and seen great success. Amy was one where she coaches volleyball, and her fear of needles was keeping her from getting the vaccine. And it started to kind of equate, like, my fear of needles, my fear of getting COVID, and realized she had to get the vaccine, talked to her NP, Kate, and Kate called us, and it was pretty awesome. She came in, we put the headset on her, we started kind of poking at her, doing some, you know, testing ahead of time, seeing, you know, and she's super competitive. She coaches volleyball. So we had a game, so she had to pop balloons, but she had to pick the right color or she had a negative score. It worked incredible. And this young woman tried everything. She had psychotherapy, different medications to try to get over this fear. And she actually used VR and was able to get vaccinated with it. And then from there, Sarah, who's just an incredible young woman, and I don't know if you read any of the articles that are published about her. They dubbed her Miracle Mom. And when she was able to get vaccinated, she also had a fear of needles. We met her at MCR, basically let her swim with dolphins while she was getting vaccinated for both shots. And it was incredibly powerful. And then because of Sarah, we just left the headset at our vaccine clinic at MCR to learn more about how do we operationalize this with labs and with this type of experience. Because the one thing you don't want to do when you go in to get labs done is be there longer than needing to. So we don't need the technology to add a lot of time to your visit. So we want to get it down to 90 seconds or less. And so we left it in the clinic, learned a lot more, tried to figure out how to get it to a really fast turnaround for someone who is afraid of needles. Go grab it, put it on, hit play, go. So it's really not adding a lot of extra time. So this one's just fun and shows kind of what we're trying to do out in the community and helping young kids understand science, understand healthcare. And we have a partnership with St. Brain School District Innovation Center. And every year they kind of do a different health project with us, and we mentor them in different ways. And last year, they wanted to do something that around joy, empathy, and connection. Because everyone was impacted by COVID, and they saw it in their peers, and these are high school sophomores and juniors. They saw it in their peers, and you know, they saw it every single day, and they wanted to do something really connected people, and they wanted to use VR to do it. So they went out and talked to other students, and they said, you know, what's some of the most the largest experiences that bring that anxiety. And they talked about that eighth grade to ninth grade transition. Now, I remember that, going from a smaller school where you kind of know everyone to a larger school where it's like you're now the youngest, and it's very, can be very fearful. So they basically went through, did their own content, even used drone footage. I mean, these kids are incredible with what they can do, and put together like an immersive experience around what's it like to be at high school for the first time. And then they went and tested it, and they actually saw a pretty reasonable 24%, which is really pretty good, reduction in anxiety before they kind of talked to the students before they did the experience about what they were feeling, and then after. But what it really shows is just the technology can be used to not just connect us, not just make us understand something a little more, but really help other people. And that's what these community collaborations are all about, and inspiring younger generation to think about this technology differently. And even though it's not commonplace, not everyone owns one, not everyone has one at home, but the more we have people thinking about how we can use it, how we can use it differently, but more importantly, how we can use it to make a difference, the stronger that technology is going to get. I told you in the beginning that if you think, remember one thing, it's that it enhances human connection. And I'm leaving you with that and with the story of Ben. Ben was receiving treatment for his cancer down in Denver. And Rocky actually did an experience for us last year, and he's pretty incredible. So it's really neat in VR because you see him doing all his acrobatic stuff around you. And we actually put the headset on Ben. And he watched it, and he's a huge Nuggets fan. This was actually during the finals. And he just had this huge smile on his face. He's looking all around, because you can look up, down, all around you. And then when he took the headset off, Rocky was standing right in front of him. And he nearly fell out of his chair. Rocky's quite the celebrity. And you can see on the right-hand side, it was an immediate hug. And it's just one of those things that I'm telling you, it feels like you put this thing on to escape from reality, and I just talked about that. But this technology will start changing how we connect with each other in the future. It may not be a headset. It may be completely different. But as it grows and as it changes, we can use this to enhance our connections with one another. And that's where we're focused in healthcare. There's a lot of different use cases I didn't talk about today. But like I said, one thing to remember is that. So thank you.